My name is Noah Wilson Rich, and I'm a scientist and CEO of the Best Bees Company. We are a team across the United States of scientific beekeepers.
In terms of thinking about bees beyond just honey, can you talk a bit about why bees matter?
Honey, you know, it's a byproduct. It is something that for a bee scientist or for many beekeepers, it's actually not why we do it. So bees, just like every organism in the natural world, whether they're plants or mushrooms or microorganisms living in the dirt, everything has an ecological role, meaning everything does something. Maybe that's like a termite getting rid of wood that falls in the forest and turns that into soil. And what pollinators can do is they promote more plants. Pollination is how we get more plants, at least the plants that produce flowers. So anytime we want more plants, we can often thank a pollinator. Pollinators get a benefit from visiting flowers by collecting nectar. They make that into honey, but that's not really their ecological role. Honey is really for them, just like my lunch is for me. But my role here, while my lunch, my honey might fuel our conversation today, my role, my purpose here is really to have a really fun conversation about bees and to empower people with how they can help and build community along the way.
Can you talk a bit about the data that you're collecting and why it matters?
Honeybee hives give us information. It's telling us how the environment is doing. So a fancier term for a research beehive is a barometer of ecosystem health. A barometer is just something that measures something else, and it tells us about the planet. It tells us how our habitat is doing. Our scientific beekeepers are collecting over 70 different data points from beehives. Honey is keeping information of all the plant DNA where the bees went to, and it's telling us the species of plants that are in our environment. And that tells us some really interesting things. I mean, a fun one is just tells us what we're tasting, because even today we call all honeys honey, but honey is fruit juice. It's plant juice. It's a taste of our local environment. So from where you are, Kate, in San Antonio, your honey tastes like San Antonio. And for me, I'm in San Francisco today. My honey will taste like the Castro neighborhood only because the variety of plants is very different. So where it's fun going beyond taste and into the science is it gives us a map of how to recreate, let's say, San Francisco or San Antonio in another area because we know all the plants that the pollinators are going to. And it gives us a way to measure over time climate change because we can see what plants are starting to be lost. We can see what plants are gained, which ones are native, which ones are great for other pollinator species to forage and nest upon. And my favorite thing about it is it gives us an opportunity to have a dialogue with our local community and to share with them, hey, here's a list of our pollinator plants. Which ones are your favorites? Are any of these relevant to your culture where we maybe should plant a pollinator garden that can give us some food and then we can share recipes and break bread together?
Is it common for a bee to kind of prefer one plant in the local area, or do you notice that they're sourcing nectar from a variety of plants?
Even though there are bees called squash bees that prefer squash plants, they also go to other plants to forage. Same thing with the blueberry bee. They also go to some other types of plants. So we do see a varied diet with pollinators. And I think that over time, that 100 million years of evolution with honeybees, that there was probably some reason why bees were favored to have a more varied diet than just one thing. We want to educate, of course, but educating alone isn't enough. So we have to educate and then inspire. So one of the approaches that we do at Best Bees is we work with artists and designers. I'm a scientist, I'm a numbers person. I also like to study bees, you know, like poking insects. That doesn't translate to everybody. And yet the big challenge that we're working on is how to save the bees, how to improve pollinator health, how to stabilize our food system, how to make sure that we have more plants that are healthy and taking in carbon from the environment. So any creative way that you can bring in art builds what's called an infographic. The info, the data, the graphic to engage people, and it's just the most amazing opportunity for creativity. And so I'll just say a message for kids, keep that creativity going. Challenge yourself with, well, can I draw this out? Or can I dance it out? Can I communicate in some way? The first presentation I ever gave as a student was a competitive science talk, and my work at the time before bees was with termites. I was showing three new termite behaviors that had never been before discovered, and my slides and my video stopped working, and I could no longer show what the termites were doing, and I panicked on stage. So for anybody who's been in a competition, you know that feeling, oh my gosh, what do? Do I run off the stage or do I act it out? And that's what I did. And I said, I'm gonna dance this science out. And I danced how termites scratch, how they feel itchy. I danced how termites vibrate. And I danced how they, what I called, raise their abdominal tip. So like their butt, it was like a booty dance, like boop. And while I did not win that competition, I felt so proud of myself for not quitting and getting creative in how to communicate the science for what these new termite behaviors were. And I had a lot of fun doing it, and anybody can do this too. And it's really required in this modern world because that's what people will remember. Even if I didn't win, people learned about those termite behaviors, just like you did.
Well, thank you so much for your time. And it was really great learning from you and talking with you.
It is a pleasure. Thank you for the opportunity.